Yo, the 90s Woodstock. If you go on, I think it's HBO Max. Go to HBO Max. They have a documentary about Woodstock that was actually like really good. It's really good, but there's a little twist to it. They talk a lot about what went wrong, and I don't know. It gets a little bit not political, but like social commentary a little bit. They talk about how in the 90s they marketed White Rage. I don't know if you're familiar with White Rage. You don't have HBO Max in Canada? Really? Do you have like an alternate? Like an alternative to it? Do you have like, was it HBO Plus? HBO Now? Anything or something like that? Isn't there? Because I know you can't get ESPN Plus in like India or something, but then they have Star Plus, which is like almost the same thing, same company and everything. But like, yeah, man. I'll tell you a little bit more about it because I'm not worried about spoilers. Because if you're unable to see it, that kind of sucks. You have Crave. Okay, gotcha. Well, if you are able to get their Woodstock documentary, I forgot what it was called, but it's pretty obvious what it is because it's like a big picture of Woodstock. And it's specifically about the Woodstock 99, not so much 94, although they discuss the other ones. And they talk about how like they marketed White Rage, where like it was just like suburban white kids that are mad for no reason. And I was like, man, this is actually pretty deep. I never thought about any of this stuff, you know, but it's really true. Like there were these bands out there, and I mean, Limp Bizkit's kind of guilty of it, but like, I think there are worse, but Limp Bizkit was definitely like the most popular. So they got the most blame for Woodstock, but there definitely was this like element of like, I'm a white teenage boy in a suburban neighborhood, and I have nothing to be mad about, so I'm mad for no reason, right? Like, I'm gonna break stuff, and, you know, like, I'll break your face, and, like, just music about, like, breaking faces, and just, like, being mad over nothing. NuMetal, yeah. I mean, well, that's the thing, though, man. I liked NuMetal. There were some bands that they were a little bit deeper than just I want to break stuff. Like honestly, Slipknot, as much as they are angsty NuMetal-y, their lyrics are pretty like visual, symbolic, and I really like their lyrics. I didn't feel, but they definitely had like, you know, the I'm angry for no reason. You know, they even admit it. Like they're like, oh, we're just a bunch of like white kids from Des Moines, Iowa. We had like literally nothing to talk about, so all we talked about was like just pure adrenaline, you know. Yeah, I unironically like NuMetal. I like Limp Bizkit, I like Korn, you know, like Mudvayne and all that, and I mean that like non-ironically. I genuinely do enjoy that music, totally. There's definitely something to it, but you know, the thing about it is I like an intelligent person, I use that angry music as like a release, as like what do you call it, like a catharsis almost. I didn't take it at face value and think I literally need to go to the concerts and start beating people up, you know. But apparently there's people that did that. That's the problem, man. I think Dave Chappelle said it once. It's like you know, when he had his show, you know, he became kind of what he called socially irresponsible. And it's like you make like satire, or you make like a certain thing, and you expect your audience to be smart enough to not go crazy with it, you know? Like, Dave Chappelle, like, think about his show, right? It's around the same time as NuMetal was big, too. His show came out, and, like, I mean, he definitely, like, used the N-word a lot. You know, like, that he had that show, like, you know, it's like, what was it? Where he was, like, a milkman, and it was, like, it looked like, Leave It to Beaver. But, like, it was a family where their last name literally was the N-word. And, you know, it was like stuff like that. And, you know, he was doing it like to be like a kind of like a parody, a satire. And he said that like white frat boys would like come up to him on the street and like yell the N-word at him. And he's like, this is having the opposite effect that I wanted it to have. You know, so he said he called it like socially irresponsible. Yeah, man. Marilyn Manson, his old stuff is really good. Because his old stuff is, like, industrial, almost like Nine Inch Nails, but it's, like, a little bit more like Nine Inch Nails, but, like, on more drugs, you know? I liked Marilyn Manson back then. Now, I heard he went, like, Christian or something. I feel like that is the worst, most attention-seeking decision that he could possibly have done. How could Marilyn Manson go religious? I think he did it for sympathy because, you know, he got accused of like beating women or something like that and being emotionally abusive and everything like that. And he probably figured that like the only people that would accept him is Christians. So. Incubus? I still listen to Incubus. Brandon Boyd actually has a solo song that just came out. It's really good. Korn, they kind of lost me. Incubus, I'll still listen to them. Rage Against the Machine, always relevant. Deftones, 100,000%. Still love the Deftones. Those guys are the best. Like, the friggin'... Like, I don't even know what genre they are. Are they really nu metal? Like, they were, like, grunge when they first came out. And, like, that first album, what was it called? Adrenaline? That was, like, grunge, man. I love Deftones. I still do. Now, they're a bit, like, experimental, a little bit prog metal. But they never hit me as a nu metal band. I always, whenever I heard the Deftones, I heard grunge, punk, you know, stuff like that. I mean, maybe a little. There's a couple of songs where, like, he kind of raps a little bit, maybe. Might come off as nu metal. But yeah, man. And I've never seen them live. I've seen Incubus live. I've seen System of a Down live. You love the song Drive by Incubus, then they made their sellout album? Which album was a sellout album? I liked Science, and I liked the one that had Pardon Me on it. I forgot what it was. I think it was called Make Yourself, now that I think about it. And then they had a band called album called Morning View. I think Make Yourself and Morning View are my favorite albums by them. What do you mean by sold out, though? Like they changed to make money? I think they were already making money with Make Yourself, with Pardon Me, Stellar, Drive. Like, they were making money there. That was big gains right there. Big gains for Incubus. The next album was really good. It was a little less rock, a little more like, or a little less metal, a little more like rock, you know. But I liked it. Yeah. The Make Yourself album is it's really good. But I do like Morning View also. I think they're both really good. It was after that though that they kind of lost me, but I'll still listen to the old stuff. I always liked Yeah, I can't think of a single bad song on Make Yourself. That whole album was That was a jam right there. It was a jam. I'm gonna be signing off soon, but there was one more thing I wanted to bring up that I thought was like pretty wild. Here, let me do the emotes real quick. Hold on, I love the emotes. I'm really happy with the way the emotes came out, actually. Let's see, the ghosts. Yeah. What was I gonna say? Oh yeah, I was looking up the founder badge. My so I guess the people that the people that subscribed to me like when I first started. And you want to know something pretty lame about it? I don't think any of them watch anymore. When I saw that, I was like, man, like that sucks. The song with whales. What that was on Science, right? What was that? That was one of their songs. It sounded like Sonic the Hedgehog. I forget which. Like, let me see. Yeah, people come and go. It's just kind of weird, though, man. Like, to not one of my founders still watches. And I was pretty shook by that. Let me see. The one song that sounded like Sonic. Let's see. Right? You'd hear it, right? And then when it kicks in too. It's in my mind. There you go. I don't want to get DMCA'd, so I think that's under fair use if I play it because I'm like talking about it and analyzing it. But yeah, like that sound. I always heard Sonic the Hedgehog when that played. I like the warmth. That was a good one. That was more vocal though, right? Oh, that's the one with the whale sounds. Yeah, they had really good bass. I like that. You were a founder on a big streamer, but you moved on. Well, you know what? I guess you're right. You know, you can't. Like, I don't fault any of them for not being around. I'm not. Especially with all the hiatuses I've taken and stuff like that. I mean, I get it. I get that if like people either forgot or they didn't survive a name change, like I changed a name and they were like, I don't know who that is, and they just didn't come back. Yeah, it's unfortunate. I do miss a lot of the folks I had before, but I do have like new people that I meet. It's tough though, you know. You try to kind of form a clique. Like, I love having viewers, like people that just come to Twitch to like chill and watch. But I have a really hard time making like good relationships with other streamers. I think the problem is, I think everybody's just really like on the grind trying to get their stuff going, and like the market is really saturated, so it's a really heavy grind. So it's like to try and like strap down and like work together, it's tough, man, because like you would have to find something that you both want to do at a time where you can both benefit, right? And if you can't do one thing together, you're gonna have to like probably like do like a tit for tat thing where like, you know, oh, like you come play, you know, Doom with me, and then like, you know, on Friday I'll join your stream, and like, you know, you know, just kind of like try to, you know, mutual. It's tough though. Like I meet a lot of people, but it's like I feel like I either have my relationship is either I watch or they watch. There's no like there's no like mutual like rating. Like my like the schedule is kind of whack. I get hosted, you know, but like it's usually they're like offline because, you know, I mean, I don't hate the host, but it's like the back and forth rating would be pretty cool. Yeah, well, clicks are tough, man, because then I also get this like imposter syndrome where I feel like I'm like annoying everybody, and then I just kind of I back myself out of the click. I don't know if that happens to you. But it definitely happens to me, man. Just when things are going well, I'm like, I'm being annoying. They hate me. I'm showing up too much. I'm being too like I'm putting up myself on too much, and then I back away. And then I don't know. I think that's a mistake because I think usually once I reach that point, things just fall to pieces. Yeah, human relations, right? Thought I didn't have to do that anymore. So I didn't have to like make friends and stuff. It's like COVID now. I'm supposed to hang out in my man cave by myself. But yeah, like yeah, it's weird, man. I definitely want to start getting more into like co-streaming and networking and stuff. I make a lot of excuses, and I mean they're valid excuses, like my schedule. I got the kids, so like if I play something off hours, I usually have to like be mic off, you know, which kind of sucks. Yeah, you don't want to bother people. I get the same way, man. I get the same way, and it sucks because it's like not true. I don't think like I think like it's in my head, and like they don't feel that way, and you know, I back off and I was like, let me give them space. Let me like not call, and then they don't call and check back in with me. And I think to myself, oh, I was right. They don't want me around, and you know, and it's like stupid. So like, my friendships usually involve like a year where I don't talk to them, and then like a couple months where I'm just like every day, like, yo, what's up? How you doing? You know, I'm trying to get better than that, but. That's just how I am, and it's definitely the same way with networking on Twitch and stuff, you know. And I try to stay away from Twitter because once I get in there, I get like way too like anxious because I see shit that I don't want to see, and so I'm not on Twitter. At least not heavy on Twitter. I pop in. I'll check like people's Twitter's, like instead of going to Twitter and checking my timeline, I'll literally go to like people I actually care about, check their timeline, and then X out. Like I'll check like Hawksick, Drizzle, and then like a couple of bigger streamers. You know, I check like Caleb and stuff, see what he's doing. Unaleska, all the Final Fantasy folks. But yeah, I try to stay off of Twitter proper. Well, I'll tell you what, man. No matter how reclusive you ever get, as long as you don't change your name and not tell me, you're always welcome to come back. No matter how much time you spend away, like when you're ready to come back, don't even sweat it, man. Because I'm the same way, and I get it. And like nothing feels better to me than like. After that long time of not talking to a friend and coming back and them like just like being happy to see me and like actually having stories and stuff to tell, like That's awesome. Yeah, definitely, man. But yeah, that's going to do it for me. Thanks for coming to my TED Talk, where I shoot demons and then I battle my inner demons in a long monologue. I'll try to be back tomorrow. Maybe we can finish up this chapter of Doom. And at some point, I would like to finish up Final Fantasy 5 before 6 comes out. And yeah, that's going to do it for me. You'll have a great night, and I'll see you next time. Bye.